It's time for the Car Doctor on AM 950 WROL. Got a car question? Call us at 617-770-3030. That's 617-770-3030. Now, here's the Car Doctor, John Paul, on AM 950 WROL, the Spirit of Boston.
And good Saturday morning, everyone, and welcome to another edition of the Car Doctor program on AM 950 WROL, the Spirit of Boston, or maybe 100.3 FM, or maybe you're listening on the app. You can go to any app store now and go download WROL radio. You can tell Alexa something. Alexa's always listening. She's always there.
Yes, she is. Yeah. I don't have one, thankfully.
What somebody told me once, they were talking with their wife or something, they told a joke, and like they laughed, their wife laughed, and then
Alexa laughs.
Yeah, and Siri laughed. And they're like,
Alexa has a creepy laugh. And,
yeah, I don't know. Mine's off. I mean, it's not off. It's just I have it plugged into my stereo, so when I do use it for a radio, it sounds good, so.
But it's listening. We're going off track here.
Yeah, I know. But I'm easily distracted. Uh-oh.
Our guest went away.
Uh-oh.
What happened?
Where'd they go? I don't know. But she was there a minute ago, so maybe she'll call back.
Hopefully.
Yeah. That might be her number, if you want to.
Let me give it a shot.
Okay. So, anyway, we are going to be talking with Julie Blakely from iseecars.com. They just did a study about whether or not you can get a better deal buying online or shopping at a regular brick-and-mortar store. So we'll be talking to her about that. There was an article that came out recently, and it says more than half the drivers surveyed by Consumer Reports have credited their vehicle with helping them avoid a crash. But many people apparently don't reciprocate and help keeping between the lines on the road. The survey of advanced driver assistance systems reported higher satisfaction with adaptive cruise control, automatic emergency braking, blind spot warning, lane keeping features were less popular or effective with respondents. Overall, 57% of respondents said technology saved them from a fender bender. Mike Monticello, an auto reporter for Consumer Reports, told Automotive News that it's important how the systems notify users, changes in their environment, and if these systems are implemented in an annoying way or if they're too sensitive, people tend to turn them off, which is what I tend to do to some of them as well. But the article is headlined, "At least our cars are still paying attention or staying alert," which is what I said about self-driving cars. At least somebody's paying attention. Well, our buddy Julie is with us again. I'm just going to blame Dennis because I'm going to blame you for disconnecting Julie.
My fault this time.
Oh, yeah.
Sure, my fault.
Sure. Well, good morning, Julie.
Good morning. How you doing, John?
I'm doing just fine. And the headline you guys sent out was pretty interesting. Do you get a better deal buying from a brick-and-mortar dealership, or do you get a better deal shopping online? And I guess it really depends. The answer is it depends where you live, right?
Right. So we're seeing a lot of online dealers in the news. CarMax is starting to deliver vehicles, and you can conduct the whole transaction online. So we were curious to see if online dealers provide better deals. And as you said, we found that on average, you can get a better deal if you just look at prices as a whole. Online dealers actually offer a slightly better deal than traditional dealers, what we found.
Well, I guess it would make sense that they probably have a lot less overhead, but I guess to get the word
exactly.
out, they have to do
exactly.
a lot more advertising. I know I drove by the one that looks like the big vending machine, Carvana,
right.
I think it is.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
I was in Florida, and I drove by the Carvana thing, which truly does look like a big vending machine. I didn't see a lot of activity there, and I have seen here locally a truck, mm-hmm. a Carvana truck delivering car to somebody. But I know I looked on their website, and at least for used cars, the prices looked average at best. I didn't, you know, I didn't see anything that I would call a ridiculously good deal. So,
right, and they also have no haggle pricing, mm-hmm. so you know they might present themselves as a little lower. And as you said, they're new to the market. A lot of people are reluctant to buy cars online because it's such a major purchase. So they're trying to gain market share, and they also, as you said, have low overhead. They don't really have to pay for sales staff and, you know, dealership lots. So as a result, they're able to, you know, have more competitive pricing. Yeah.
Now, you mentioned no haggle pricing. There are some experts that will say that no haggle pricing isn't really the best deal.
Right. You know, but there are also consumers that don't like
would rather give birth to a child, you mean, than go car shopping?
Exactly. So I think for some people, they see a deal, and they know that, you know, that's as low as the dealer is going to go, and they're willing to accept that price, especially if they see that it's lower than what local dealers around them are offering.
Now, some of the numbers you put out about the the best savings, you actually broke them down by vehicle type too. And I guess if you were going to go out and buy a Chevy Silverado pickup truck, you're better off buying it online because you can save, what was it, a little over 6.5%, right?
Right. Yeah. So as you said, we looked at the cars that on average have greater discounts at online dealers. And the opposite of that, we looked at the cars that you're more likely to find a better deal from local dealers. And the Chevy Silverado was number one. So in terms of the cars that have the most savings at online dealership, we found that they tended to be more popular cars and SUVs and trucks, while the local dealers tend to have better deals on less popular and subcompact and even discontinued cars.
And When you're looking at some of the metro areas, for instance, it looks like the difference between, you know, buying something in Boston or Manchester, the savings from the dealer looks like it's a pretty good size number.
Right. So we compared metro areas, and we found that in Boston, the Ford Edge was the car that has the greatest discount from an online dealer by 9%, and the Chevy Sonic was the car that you can get a deal from a local dealer, and that was also about 9.8%.
Yeah, which is so you actually still, I mean, what it comes down to is you still have to do your homework, right?
Of course.
Yeah.
Of course, and people aren't really aware of online dealers, and like I said, people are scared to buy cars online, so we just want to let them know that they could be a good option. There's no substitute for doing research, but you know, if you really don't like going to the dealership, which a lot of people don't, you can, you know, get a good deal on a car if you want to purchase it online, and you can get all the financing done. Yeah, they do everything for you.
And well, and let's talk about iseecars.com for a minute.
Sure.
Your boss started the company because he didn't like the car buying experience, right?
Exactly. Him and his co-founder had both went through a very lengthy used car search process, and they thought that there had to be a better way, so that inspired them to develop the used car search engine that iseecars has become.
And one thing that I think kind of sets one of your features apart from your search engine is the vehicle identification number, the VIN reader, which kind of give us kind of the Reader's Digest version of what that does.
Sure. So we have a tool that's available on our website and also through an app. And what's great about the app is that you can be on a used car lot and you can scan a vehicle's VIN, and it will give you pricing analysis. It will tell you, you know, if the car you're looking at is the best deal or if you can get a better deal, you know, at a dealer close by, mm-hmm. unless you know projected depreciation. So basically, we like to say that it's a one-stop shop. We give you all the analysis that you need to help you make that purchasing decision just by scanning a vehicle's VIN number.
And even it even goes as far as there's a link to NHTSA to check and see about recalls.
Right.
Yeah.
Yep. So recalls, and even something that people might not think of is if the car is stolen, if it has been stolen. So there's a lot of interesting information that you can get.
I know
helpful information.
Yeah, I know when I was car shopping about a year or so ago, and your app, that app, I think, probably was just out by then, and I mm-hmm. played with it, and I scanned it on my own car. And,
yeah.
And which, you know, I was like, oh, that's kind of neat. And then I went car shopping, and mm-hmm. I went into a dealer, and they had a used car and that was only about 6 months old, and I asked them what they would give me for a trade-in, and I think they went back and forth, and they said, well, we can give you like $900. And I said, well, that's interesting, because let me show you this. And I showed them what your app showed, and it was more like $6,000. And I also said to them, apparently you have a car very similar to mine at one of your dealerships for $6,000, according to the app. Because then I went back to iseecars, did a search. Mm-hmm. It popped up one of their sister dealerships. And I said, "So you're offering me $900, but you're selling it for $6,000. I think we can negotiate a little bit better here."
Wow. Yeah, they picked the wrong consumer. Right, and that's a great point. Is that it also helps? You know, if you're selling your car, a lot of people might not know you know how to price their vehicle,
right.
And yeah, it gives you insight on a competitive, fair price.
And it really, and that's one of the things. I get phone calls all the time at work or emails, and the people have a car they want to sell. And unfortunately, the book value, sort of the NADA mm-hmm. guides and Kelley Blue Book, and, you know, the old-fashioned book, you know, if you looked at an NADA book, mm-hmm. it would say used car guide. And guide mm-hmm. is the real word, because it's not used car. This is how much it costs. It's like, it's a guide to give you an idea where pricing is. And mm-hmm. the better way is to do like a search with you guys. And you can say, mm-hmm. well, here's six or seven cars, very similar. And this is what they're going for. And you can more closely get your price, what you're looking, what you can figure out a better idea, mm-hmm. almost a kind of a self-appraisal. If you look at six or seven cars mm-hmm. and they all have similar mileage and they're in similar condition, and you can say, and then especially if you look and you say, well, this person's been trying to sell this car for 3.5 months, well, obviously that's mm-hmm. overpriced. So
exactly.
You know, cars are kind of like real estate. If it's priced right, it'll sell right. And when somebody right. wants too mm-hmm. much money for a house, or somebody wants too much money for a car, it's just not going to sell. But if they price it appropriately, it's going mm-hmm. to sell. So your system allows you to do that. Speaking mm-hmm. of which, how do people get cars listed on your site?
Sure. So we actually have a tool where you can list your car. If you go to the desktop version of our site, mm-hmm. and it's easy, you just upload the information, some pictures, and it's free to list your vehicle on our site.
So if Dennis wanted to sell his wife's car without her knowing it.
Mm-hmm. Of course. Great idea.
As long as he has a new one ready to go. But if he wanted to do that, he could just take a couple pictures of it, do a little bit of research, upload it to the site, and then suddenly it's available to how many millions of people?
We have in
lots.
The millions for
lots.
Sure, right? across the country. So yeah, it's a great tool to sell your vehicle.
Yeah, and what's nice, if you're searching. And maybe you're searching for that unicorn of a car and you're willing to, mm-hmm. you know, go cross country to look for it. But if mm-hmm. you don't want to do that, you're looking for just, you know, a good car, you can put a lot of filters in, so you can do color, mm-hmm. you can do geographical location, you can do price, you can do mileage. So you can really narrow your search pretty easily if you're looking for a car.
Yeah, Right. So my husband was very specific when he was looking for a car. He wanted something with a roof rack and other certain features. And, yeah, iseecars allowed him to find exactly the vehicle that he wanted.
Mm. Yeah, that does it makes it a lot easier. So kind of in summary, if we are going to go out and buy a car, you know, online dealerships could save you a little bit of money. If you really want to save a lot of money in the Boston metro area, you have to buy a Chevy Sonic. I don't recommend anyone ever does that. I think there are better cars than that.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, and something that I also didn't point out that's important is that in Carvana and with online dealers, the age of the cars tend to be around 3 years. Mm-hmm. The vast majority are off-lease vehicles.
Mm-hmm.
So if you want something maybe 5 years old or a little older, then you likely won't be able to find it.
Right. Right. So, yeah, and some of the off-lease can mean different things to different. It could be it could be that I leased a car for 3 years and it's off a lease and it's in, or but it also could possibly be a Hertz or an Avis or a budget rent a car.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah. Which I think I bought at least two, maybe three former rentals, and they were good cars. There was nothing wrong with them, but now the rental car companies are kind of wringing out every last mile out of them. And now instead of having 15 or 20,000 miles on them, they have 50 and 60,000 miles on them. And 50 or 60,000 miles driven by 10,000 people and may not be the best used car. So I always tell people if you are shopping, really be kind of specific where it is, where it came from. And same thing with them. You know, with all the floods we had all across the country and continuing, you know, if that car came from Louisiana or Texas or certain areas, you might want to look extra careful at that car. I know when I was shopping a year ago, I looked at a car and it had it was a former lease car, and I looked under it and it was just covered in mud. I said something to the dealer. I said, where? He said, oh, we just got this in. I'm sure, you know, I said, got it in from where? And we never drew any conclusions. My conclusion was for them to put it out for sale and not wash it. How much care did it really get?
Exactly.
So, yeah. So, so it always makes sense. You know, do all your homework, do all your research, and sites like yours where you can do that has a lot of research tools, I think for a lot of people can make a huge amount of difference and not make a mistake. And, you know, when you're looking at the, you know, second or third largest purchase you're going to make, don't make a mistake doing it.
Exactly. Take your time. And like you said, do your research.
Mm-hmm.
Right. There's a lot of things to consider.
And it is, at the end of the day, it is just a car. It's not, you know, it's not, you didn't just buy a puppy. It's a car, so it's something that they'll make another one, and if you missed out on that one, there'll be another one that will come up, and there's plenty of them out there, and you can go shop around and try to find them, right?
Right, exactly.
So, I mean, I always feel guilty whenever I say this because it sounds so weird, but you know, buy with your head, not your heart, when it comes to buying.
Exactly.
A car. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And plan ahead for long term too.
Yeah,
exactly. You know, if you're planning on having a big family, you might, you know, want to plan for that instead of getting a car that you're likely going to outgrow.
So like right now I'm driving the new Toyota Supra. Not a family car.
Right.
Julie, have you seen this Supra thing yet? The new Supra?
I've seen pictures. I've never seen one in person.
It is.
It's a nice looking car.
It's funky looking.
That's Dennis's professional opinion on that. So
the red mirrors on the white car look a little weird.
Yeah, but that's the launch edition. That's the special edition that just came out. So that's
right.
So it's a little bit different. But anyway, always good information. The website again is the letter I, iseecars.com. So you can go find out all kinds of information. And, you know, and for me, sometimes I go to your site. with no intention of at all of buying. I just like to sometimes look and see what's there.
Right.
Yeah. Just
right.
Kind of,
I do too.
Yeah. It's sort of virtual fantasy shopping.
Exactly. Kind of like the real estate apps. It's always helpful to know what's out there.
That's right.
And because I get asked this question all the time, it is the letter I and then S-E-E cars dot com.
Mm-hmm.
Not icy, not I-C.
Right. Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Spell it out.
Exactly, right. And I think the last time we talked, you were on your way to Disney World, right?
Oh, my goodness, yes.
Yeah.
We might have talked, but yeah, that was back in February.
Yeah.
Great family trip. We're looking ahead, maybe doing it next year. But, yeah, my first time at Disney, it was quite fun. A lot of work. I needed another vacation afterwards, but completely worth it. The kids, we all had tons of fun.
Did you heed my advice and go left when everybody else went right?
Yes.
It works.
That was great. It does work. It does work.
You should have given that advice to my wife when she took our nephew's three daughters there. They waited in line a lot. Hey, Julie, always a pleasure talking to you. And the website, again, iseecars.com, all kinds of great information in there, all kinds of fun stuff to look at. Always a good way, you know, when I tend to be scrolling through your website and, like you said, the real estate app and, you know, Facebook Marketplace and all that stuff while I'm watching TV. It's one of those things that I just kind of do and always fun to look at. Julie, thanks for checking in with us, and have a great rest of the day and try to stay cool.
Oh, you too. Thank you so much.
All right.
It was a pleasure, John.
All right. Take care, Julie. Bye-bye.
Bye.
And also, if you go on their site and look around, you can find my Q&A call. There's a Q. She's kind enough to post my Q&A column from time to time. So it's always nice to see that there. And I forget it's here every once in a while. And every once in a while, I'll get an email from somebody who says, oh, I read your Q&A column on the iseecars.com website, and I have a question for you. And I'm like, oh, I forgot. Yeah. So because my column is in today's Boston Globe, today's Providence Journal, once in a blue moon, Bob Bosworth puts it in the Quincy Sun. Not that often. But I like Bob, so.
It was being in there quite a bit.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, I think it's space available, sort of thing.
Since I'm on my quote-unquote summer home, I don't get the sun at this point.
You don't get
anymore.
The sun at your summer home?
At my summer home.
What, in the Hamptons?
Yeah. Well, the Quincy Hamptons.
The Quincy Hamptons, yeah. It's the East Hamptons, yeah. Yeah, so, and it's also, if you're listening out in the sort of western-ish part of the state, Blackstone Valley area, the Yankee Express, the Blackstone Express. There's four or five little weekly papers out there. Barbara is the editor out there. Really nice people. And it's actually, I like these weekly papers. I think they're, when they're done right, like the Quincy Sun and they do a nice job. Also, if you're in Connecticut, the Connecticut Penny Saver, which I've never seen a physical copy of. I read the online version.
I don't know what it's like in other places, but my only complaint about the Quincy Sun is it feels like I'm reading a choose-your-own-adventure book.
Really?
I start the article on one page.
Mm-hmm.
It says continued on another page.
Yeah.
And then it says continued on another page. And then it says continued on another page
really?
Sometimes.
Really? Like, well, the big complaint I got last week in the Providence Journal, which is the other place my column is read, is somebody said and they call that a jump when it goes from one page to the next. That's the apparently the professional newspaper or, you know, thing. The jump page is not always accurate. So it's like Paul, section C11. It's at the end of my column, so you go to C11 to finish my column up, and sometimes it's in the real estate section.
Oops.
So
yeah, that doesn't happen in the Sun.
Yeah.
Pretty good.
And the Boston Globe, it's one page, but for a while it said, you know, Car Doctor Q&A, and it'll say, like, page 3, and it'd be, like, page 7. So, but it's been pretty consistent now at the Globe, so. All good things. Why don't we take a quick break? Remember the website, iseecars.com. You can find out more information, find out where the better deals are. And when we come back, I want to talk about a study that AAA put out this week about vehicle escape tools. Everyone worried about being trapped in your car?
All the time.
That news. That
well, I am crash after all.
That you're falling. Dreams you're falling. Right. You ever do that? Yeah. You know, being chased by someone. All kinds of stuff. It's all. We can't help you with the falling dreams or being chased, but we'll tell you about vehicle escape tools when we get back. My name is John Paul. This is the Car Doctor Program. If you have a question, give us a call at 617-770-3030. Phone lines are open. We'll be right back.
I read about his widowed bride, but something touched me deep inside the day the music died. So bye.
I was taking a trip out to L.A., tooling along in my Chevrolet, talking on a number and digging on the radio. Just as I crossed the Mississippi line, I heard that highway start to whine, and I knew that left rear tire was about to go.
Well, the spare and welcome back to the Car Doctor Program at AM 950 WROL, the Spirit of Boston, 950. We have a couple of lines open if you want to join us at 617-770-3030. But before we do that, I want to mention the latest study AAA did about vehicle escape tools, a lifesaver in the right situation. And do you ever have a fear of you just drove over a cliff and went into the water and the water's coming up around you and you can't get the windows open?
Again, my name is Crash.
I know. Yeah, I know. Couple things. The chances of that happening are almost none, just so you know. 0.5% of all the crashes involve a car going into water. Now, it happened a week ago in Falmouth, but still 0.5%. And in most cases, depending on what happens, it can be you can just open the door and get out. If it's really rushing in, you kind of wait till the water fills up about halfway, equalizes pressure on the door, and you get out. Some people say, I don't wear my seatbelt because I'm afraid I'm going to drown. Well, if you don't wear your seatbelt, you're going to hit your head, get knocked unconscious, and you'll drown. Wear your seatbelt.
Or you'll get ejected from your car.
That's right.
And a lot worse things are going to be happening.
A lot worse things are going to happen. Yeah. So wear your seatbelt. There's a couple of tools you can buy. One of them is a little tiny thing, smaller than the palm of your hand, and you push it up against the glass. It makes a snapping noise. It shatters the glass. It also has a little razor blade built into it, and you can actually cut a seatbelt if it's jammed. The only issue is car manufacturers are putting in laminated side glass now. They're saying two reasons. They're saying one of the reasons is to protect the occupants against ejection. Well, if you put your seatbelt on, that's not going to happen. The real reason, in my opinion, is it makes the car quieter. So it's the same kind of glass a windshield's made out of. It's laminated. Now, you can break a windshield. Yeah, it takes a lot of work, but you can break a windshield. So if you have one of these little shattery tools, you'd have to work a long time at it to probably try to break it, but you can break it. But it just takes a lot more work, and you have to kick it out and all that kind of work. And there's a couple of tools. There's one that it's basically an automatic center punch. It can make a little dimple. And the other one is a little hammer that people have. Throw the little hammer away because you can't get enough of a swing on the glass inside the car to actually break it with a hammer. We tested about 6 different hammers and only found one that actually was able to break the glass. The other style that you push up against the glass and it makes this little snapping sound is the only ones that really work consistently. And you can look at your car, if you're really worried about it, And it will say right on the glass, tempered or laminated. And if it's laminated, just know it's laminated. And you, and again, half of 1%. I've never worried about being drowning in my car. Never. No, I'll probably go home and have a dream tonight about drowning in my car. I also heard the other day, if you have a dream that someone's chasing you, you should turn around and say hello to them. And that makes it stop.
So the other thing that I have, especially when you're driving and this construction happening, like the highway isn't quite complete yet. Going off that incomplete part.
Dukes of Hazzard, like?
Yes.
Yeah. But we have on our, if you have a real interest of knowing which cars have laminated glass, I actually have a whole list of them. And if you want to see the whole report, I have a whole report. And just email me, and I can send it to you. My email, jpaul@aaanortheast.com. Let's talk to our
Northeast?
Buddy. What?
AAA Northeast?
Yeah, aaanortheast.com.
Okay.
It used to be AAASNE.
Yeah.
That was Southern New England.
Yeah.
And I think that still works, but it's not really us anymore, so AAA Northeast. Let's talk to our buddy Peter, who's going to, I don't know, fill us in on more Edsley stuff. Peter.
John, how you doing?
Good.
I'm good. I just wanted, I heard you last week mention the Etzeldorf Row Hotel.
Yep.
And, it was kind of an interesting thing. They reached out to me, and they wanted to make a kind of a tribute or commemoration to Ford's production.
Yep.
The hotel is right there in the assembly lane now, and they talked to me Sunday. They said, we'll talk to management. And management said yes, which I was totally floored.
Mm-hmm.
And then they picked it up Wednesday, and I gave them all young, you know, so I gave them a driving lesson, how to drive a 60-year-old automobile and how it breaks and all that.
How it doesn't break like a new car does?
Exactly, John. Yeah. They all pulled up with brand new Mini, brand new BMWs. Yep.
I would expect nothing less.
So they made it, and then it shortly after that was on Channel 5 News, because the Row Hotel is like the 42nd best hotel in the world. And inside the hotel is all automotive. Related in industrial history. So.
Oh, I'll have to, next time I'm over that way, I'll have to check it out.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
It really makes a difference. The pink light Edsel in front of a building that looks like, I don't know, gray metal and glass.
Mm.
You know, so I think it's serving their purpose. They seem to be thrilled with it. So.
And you get to go visit if you want.
Exactly, John.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. And I'm down to one old cow, which was my goal. So we continue on, as they say.
Yeah. And your old car, the car you have now is what?
62 Ford Sunliner convertible that belonged to Duddy Ford. It belonged to the ownership of Duddy Ford in 62. And it's got all the factory options, 390 car. Cruise-O-Matic transmission, and I've had that since 1974, so that's been with me a long time.
You don't get rid of much, do you?
Well, but, you know, John, if it's good, you keep it, right?
Well, that's my wife has thought that about me.
It gets
a little questionable from time to time, though.
Well, you're still in.
I'm still in, but I'm a little like your Edsel. Every once in a while, she's like, maybe I should move on.
Someone who could still climb a ladder, right?
That's right. That's right. Yeah. Exactly.
Oh.
No, that's a great story though, and for people who want to, you know, check out the car and see it, and now I'm kind of intrigued by the hotel because. Just to see what's there. I remember many, many years ago, I've been to Las Vegas only once, and I stayed at the MGM, and I didn't realize at the time that the one of the partners of the MGM hotel was the person who made the run at buying Chrysler Corporation. So as you're walking through the hotel, it was like a car show. It was every Chrysler product, including old ones, were on display. So it was kind of, nice to see. And you know, when you have something that kind of, you know, changes your interest a little bit, you know, you're like, oh, I didn't even notice that, you know, or something just different to look at while you're there kind of makes it interesting. So
exactly. And, and this hotel is renowned for its details and superb service, and so they're trying to convey the story of the Somerville assembly factory, which is, I think, is really noble because they don't have to do that, you know.
Mm.
So I don't think anyone else is really preserving the history there at all. So I feel really fortunate to have it in their hands and having the story continue. And and for them, an attention grabber for the public, and they're going to use it for special events and the rest. So I think it's a win-win all the way around.
Yeah, it sounds really good, and it's and again, it's kind of a fun thing. And you know, if they keep it for a year or they keep it 20 years, it's just a little bit of history that somebody's going to learn about and they're going to be interested in, and kind of nice to be a little bit of a part of it. So that's nice.
Absolutely, John. That's the same feeling I got. So.
Yeah.
I'm very pleased.
There you
very
go.
Very pleased. Yeah,
all right.
It all worked out.
All right. And, take care, Peter.
Thank you for your help.
All right. Sure thing.
Okay. All right, John.
Yep.
Bye-bye.
Speaking of interesting things to go to, the Volksfair and is going to be at Hebert's Candies in Shrewsbury. And that's always a good show. It's put on by the Bug Club and out of New Hampshire. And it's going to be Saturday, July 27th from 9 to 2 at Hebert's Candies. Like I said, that's up in Shrewsbury. But as part of the show this year, they're having a Deserter Dune Buggy get-together at the same time. And if you follow me on Facebook, you'll see me and my neighbor Bob underneath his Deserter putting an engine back in it. Because that's what you do when you're on vacation. And it's a Volkswagen, so it wasn't that terrible to do. But that's going to be taking place. So if you have an interest in dune buggies and kit cars and air-cooled cars like Volkswagens, go check out the Volksfair. Again, it's going to be 9 to 2. And they have candy and ice cream. Again, like going to the hotel and seeing cool stuff, you go to the car show and there's candy and ice cream. And Hebert's makes they make good candy. All right, where are we going? Skippy. Let's talk to Skippy. Skippy?
I'm Paul, sir.
There you are.
How are you?
Good. How are you?
I am. I'm here. Listen, I want to, first of all, I want to talk about AAA. Before, but you said something about a dream of when someone's chasing your dream and stop and turn around and say, well, I did that. And the guy cut my head off. So
very
well.
All right. Then don't do that then. All right. Bad advice.
All right, but as far as AAA, I've been listening to you a long time, and I said, you know, this time when I go to get my license renewed, I'm going to try. I went to the office in Quincy on Adams Street. I'm going to tell you, I tell anybody, join AAA, even if it's just for that, aside from all the other benefits you get with AAA, it was very painless. It was in and out and friendly. It wasn't this kind of bureaucratic stance and all this. They talk to you, and it made you. And they talk to you as you get the AAA credit card.
Yep.
And it was great, and you were in and you were out, and it was no fuss, no muss.
Yeah, I know. I did my license a little bit early last month or so in Rockland because I happened to be there. But a couple years ago, I finally decided that I guess I'm going to pay the Commonwealth of Massachusetts electronically when I go through a toll. And I got a toll transponder, and I went and I saw Ozzy over at the Quincy office. I did it Saturday after I left here, and he helped me set up the transponder, put my credit card information on it, and someday I'll remember what my password is to get on my Easy Pass account, but it just made it nice and easy, and they, you know, the only thing Saturday sometimes because we do all the registry services on Saturdays and the registry's closed, it can sometimes get a little bit busy, but again, we try to We try to make sure everybody stays happy. And I know we even had a line one day at one of our offices, and the manager went out and bought a bunch of little bottles of water and handed them out to everybody just to try to, you know, just say, hey, you know, we're doing the best we can. A little more people than we thought this morning. And then they also go around and say to them, hey, you know, if you're interested in, you know, going on vacation or doing this, you know, let us know, and we can, you know, we can keep your space in line and go talk to a travel agent or something too. So,
well, you know, John, Ozzy, now would he be the shot fellow with the dark hair going bald? He's kind of a shot fellow.
I don't know if he's going bald, but he's a shot fellow with dark hair. Yeah,
right. He was very good. He was very energetic walking around.
Oh yeah, he's that's Ozzy.
Very cordial.
Yeah,
and they tell you, even the Attaway Fibers, there's all kinds of travel magazines or what have you to look at.
Yeah.
There was no one having to. Maybe it was eight people there, yeah. But Friday noontime, and that's pretty good at noontime. There wasn't a whole bunch of people missing because of lunch. I advise people, get a AAA card, go there, and cut out the middleman there. You know, you don't have to go to the you cut out the registry because
yep.
A long wait in the other place.
Yep. Skippy, thanks for the AAA plug, and the other and all the right. Good advice about don't turn around and say hi to the guy chasing you, because we don't want to see we don't want anybody getting their head cut off.
Never again.
All right. Thanks, Skippy. So don't cut. Don't do that then.
Yeah. No. Don't stop.
I heard a psychologist say that the other day.
Yeah. No. I would advise against that as well.
Well, I always said most psychologists are nuts anyway. Sorry if you're a psychologist out there.
My mom is.
Is she? Is she? Is she nuts?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Sorry, Mom. Let's talk to Mike. Michael.
Car Doctor, how are you today?
Good. How are you?
Good. Just two quick ones. One is I got my new ID license up in Rockland.
Oh, okay.
Just last week. And it's, I listened there more than 20 minutes. The secret is read the manual.
Right.
I mean, you've got to do what they tell you. Go online. You know, bring the right paperwork, and you're in and out of there. And like I say, 20 minutes. Yep. And I got my new license yesterday.
It's amazing how quick it comes.
Amazing, yeah. And I got a veteran on mine. I'm a veteran. They actually mark them now.
Yeah.
Brand new veterans and such. So it was, but just up here, it was painless.
No, and you're absolutely right, because it's funny that the Rockland office is the one I stop into from time to time because it's close to home. And there was one of the girls behind the desk. I'd go over to her and say, "What do I need to do?" And she said, and she does it so much. She's like, "Two things from here, three things from here." And then like a few weeks later, I'm like, "What do I need to do?" And she said, "How many times do I have to tell you this?" And I said, "Well, a couple until I get it right." And when I came in, she wasn't there, but I had all the stuff she told me, and I even went online and printed the form out and filled most of it in before I got there. So I had all the information already, and then I saw her a couple weeks later, and I said, "I was in, and you weren't here." And she's like, "Well, I hope you did it right, because, you know, I put a lot of effort into making sure you got it right." So, and she was just joking around, but it took once I had all the information, I walked up, they're like, "Oh yeah, you got this, and this." They scanned it, you know, do the eye test. I still kind of wonder about the eye test when they say, "Do you see the things on the sides?" Who says no? but
I did once, because my glasses were blocking.
Oh, okay.
My frame was blocking them. The guy said, "Take off your glasses." I said, "Oh, yeah, I see them now."
Oh, yeah.
That
actually
happened years ago.
Yeah.
But they were really great up
there. Oh, good. Good to know.
The other thing I wanted to mention, I'll make a statement and see if it comes true. I think the automobiles and the way we deal with automobiles are going to change more in the next 5 years than they have in the last 50. And by that, I mean, once this autonomous car comes in, these electric, I think once electric cars go beyond 40% of the cars on the road, I think you buy them by Amazon. I really mean that. I mean, there's not much to break on them. I mean, a lot of the local shops can probably fix it. The motors on a Tesla are a million miles on the motors.
Yeah.
I think that's the way of the future, believe it or not. These brick and mortar are going to face the same problems that Sears and Roebuck and JCPenney face.
Yeah. And I kind of look at it and say, I think cars are still going to be an emotional purchase because I don't care what anybody says when people say to me, you know, people are going to just start looking at cars like buying a washing machine. And I think people, because they're still going to be commuting, they're still going to be, you know, if a car was only used to go to the supermarket, it would be a different story. But when you sit in your car, I drove in and out of Boston a couple times this week, and you know, to go 20 miles took me, you know, 90 minutes one day and 2 hours another day. And if you're in your car and you're comfortable and it kind of feels like home, you're not going to do that with an appliance. And I think people are going to say, yeah, my car might run on electricity and I might buy it from Amazon or Carvana or somebody and have it delivered to me. But on the other hand, it still is going to be an emotional purchase.
I think for you and I, that's true. I wonder if that's true for the 25-year-old.
Well,
that's the question. I mean, you can sit back and read his Wired magazine while he's say, you know.
Yeah.
But, hey, last question for you. Going to do a review of the Supra today?
I'm going to talk about it, certainly. Yep.
Yeah, I like to hear about it. I bought my first Toyota in 1973, and everybody laughed at me because it was made out of beer cans. It was going to rust. I'm still driving it. Well, Toyota product.
Well, you know? Some of those you could actually read Schlitz or whatever it was, what they were made out of. So yeah, the recycled beer cans. But this is a pretty interesting car. We'll take a break, and when I come back, we'll talk a little bit more about it.
Thanks a lot. Have a great
day.
Thank
you
very much.
Bye-bye. 617-770-3030, 617-770-3030. Why don't we take a quick break? When we come back, we'll do that. We'll give you my first impressions on the Toyota Supra.
Brother Bellis in the back, sweet singers in the front.
Welcome back to the Car Doctor Program on AM 950 WROL, the Spirit of Boston. Phone lines are open, 617-770-3030. On this, I don't know, how hot is it outside? 90 yet?
It can't get hot enough.
Can't get hot enough?
Can't get hot enough.
So when somebody comes up to you and goes, hot enough for you?
Nope.
You go, nope, not hot enough for me yet. About 88, feels like 97.
Woo!
So, you know, cooler in Florida, apparently. I keep hearing people talk about, you know, how it's going to be so hot. And it's like, A, it's summer. B, it's July. So it doesn't get much hotter than this. And why do we have to tell people to be, make sure you stay hydrated?
Because people be dumb.
Is that what it is? People be dumb? I heard somebody this morning, they're like, well, if you can't be in air conditioning, make sure you're in the shade. I'm like, huh, I would have never thought of that. I would have never thought about that. And the person, yeah, if you go out, make sure you bring water with you. And my wife and I were talking the other night about being kids and going to the playground. And first off, we didn't bring water with us. And if we got thirsty, there was a bubbler.
Yeah, well, that
nobody drinks out of those anymore. Yeah.
You can't find them anymore, really.
Yeah, there's a few here and there, yeah. And the other thing is, you know, if you were playing in the yard and you got thirsty, you drank out of the hose. You turn the hose on. And nobody does that. But it seemed like when I was a kid, I never saw any kids get dehydrated.
I did.
Did you?
I did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know.
It wasn't, I mean, it wasn't like, oh my God, that they were all red and
yeah.
they had headaches and they yeah. were like,
yeah, that's just from too much time out in the sun. But the point is, it's like, where did we become so, have so little ability to be self-sufficient and like have common sense? It's like,
people
yeah.
be dumb.
People be dumb. Yeah. Yeah, you know, if you can't be in the air conditioning, make sure you stay in the shade. Yeah, well.
Back on a car thing, can I ask a question? Because it drives me nuts all the time I hear one.
Sure. It's your program
pickup
too,
trucks,
you know?
Well, it's not my problem. It's your problem. Pickup trucks and cars that have diesel engines. Why can't they make a diesel engine that, what is the, that is quieter?
Because it's called compression ignition. So it actually has a high compression engine that squishes the fuel, and when it squishes the fuel, it explodes, which is why it makes that noise. And a few years ago, Ford had a diesel engine that was really quiet. The problem is it broke a lot. And the recall, when they finally recalled them or did whatever they did to them, they fixed them. And people bought them because they were quiet. And when they got them back, they were... And they're like, what'd you do? And they're like, oh, we had to change the way the fuel squirts in. And but now it sounds like every other diesel. And they're like, yeah, that's the only way we can get it to run right. So, but that's why diesels make noises, is compression.
I figured in this day and age, there's got to be a way.
Well... Diesels, though, if you went out and bought the new Ram 3500 diesel truck, big, huge truck,
big
dual rear wheels to tow your horse trailer or boat or something, inside of it, it's quiet as a Rolls Royce. Thing is super quiet inside. Now, the people next to you in traffic, they hear the diesel sound. But you as the driver, even with the windows down, it's pretty quiet. So they have done a really good job of quieting down the cabin. On the other hand, this diesel truck I was in with the 3500 with the, all the bells and whistles, $90,000. So,
it's nuts.
Yeah. Well, my when I was driving the Range Rover autobiography, so the most fancy Range Rover. In fact, if you get the Globe today, the woman who wrote the car review wrote about the same car. And somebody said to me, how much is that? I said, how much is an entry-level Peterbilt? The guy went, about $175,000. I said, about the same. And goodness. He goes, really?
Goodness.
And I'm like, yep. Okay. The new Toyota Supra. It's not even out yet, technically. The one I'm
looking at it.
Yeah, the one I'm driving, I believe, is a pre-production car. It's a launch version, which means it's the first one out there. It is a, it's powered by a 6-cylinder 3-liter engine. The drivetrain is essentially all BMW. So Toyota, rather than build a new drivetrain, decided to use BMWs, which is a little odd. You open the hood and there's a big plastic cover that has a Toyota emblem on it. But when you look under the cover, it says BMW, which I guess some people would go, that's fantastic. And other people might go, well, does Toyota build better quality than BMW?
I'm the second yeah. school there.
Yeah. Some people say, well, you know, there's no finer engine made than something BMW makes. You know, other people will go, well, it's a good engine, but it's Toyota builds better quality. What I have read online is that the engineer who designed this vehicle, designed the characteristics of the vehicle, has never driven the equivalent BMW. So everything that's tuned for this has been tuned by a Toyota engineer. So even though it's the engine, the transmission, and so forth, it is very different than, say, a BMW Z4, which is kind of the rough equivalent of it. It makes 335 horsepower. It's not a really heavy car. It weighs a couple tons, maybe close to 4,000 pounds. It has plenty of performance. It has an 8-speed automatic transmission. I understand that Toyota is going to come out with a manual shift. This has a sport mode, which changes the characteristics of how the automatic shifts, and it has paddle shifters, so you can paddle shift up and down if you like. Maybe on a track, you'd want to, driving around town, this automatic transmission shifts perfectly. And when you put it in sport mode, it firms it up. It kind of takes the gear away. So instead of being acting like an 8-speed, it out on the highway, it's even in 7th because it just feels more responsive that way. I like when you take your foot off the gas in sport mode. It goes, pop, 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 pop. Probably no one else does, but I like it. I like that sort of sporty sound. It has a nice exhaust tone to it. It handles like it's on rails. It is one of those vehicles that I don't know that I've driven anything that has got as much attention as this has. But it's the people who are really interested in it. That I was at a set of lights. I was at a set of lights yesterday, and I noticed behind me there was a guy in a Subaru WRX STI. So the hot rod Subaru with the wing on the back of it, and he was probably in his late 20s, and he was. I could see he was really eyeing the car. And he pulled up next to me. It was like a 3-lane kind of thing. He pulled up next to me in the left lane, and he's like, "Oh my God, that's a new Subaru! That's a new Supra!" And he was just like all crazy about it. And then he was behind me, and I saw he had his phone out and his video in the hallway. And then at the next set of lights, which was probably a half a mile or a mile later, he pulls up on the right side of me. And he goes, "Oh, do you mind if I take a picture of it?" And I'm like, "No, go ahead." And he's like, "That is so beautiful. That is such a beautiful car." And I said to him, "Well, your car's a really nice car, too." And he goes, "Yeah, but it's not, you know, my car's a Subaru, and it's, but he said, that Supra's beautiful." He said, I really want one of those." And I was at my desk most of the day yesterday. I must have had 5 people come to my desk and go, "Can I go out and look at your car?" And I haven't been in anything that's got that much attention in a long while. But it's from people who have, one guy had a Subaru BRZ. Somebody else had.
It's the Fast and Furious generation.
Yeah, yeah. Without a doubt. Handling, phenomenal. Performance from the engine, step on the gas, set you right back in the seat. In these days of 400 and 500 horsepower, 335 doesn't sound like a lot. It's a lot in this car, and it's a lot of torque. Very controlled. Shifting's great. Steering's good. Getting in and out. Bit of a challenge.
I cannot get in this car. There's no way I can. Oh, you can. Say I can. I'm looking at it. There's no way I can get in that car.
It's low to the ground.
It's not the low. It's
yeah.
The yeah.
Once you're in it, you'll be fine.
Once
you're in. But getting in and out of the passenger side is a little easier because there's no steering wheel in the way. Getting in and out of the driver's side, a little bit of a challenge. But once I drove this car. Back from Maine. So I drove this back from Kennebunkport, Maine, to home. It was comfortable. It was 150 miles. It was comfortable. There was nothing I could say was wrong with the ride at all. Except I like to drive with my windows down. I enjoy some fresh air. You put the windows down in this thing, and it buffets like crazy.
Well, look at it. It's not meant. It's meant to be very
aerodynamic.
Very aerodynamic.
But I still like. Have you ever been in your car and you just put the rear windows down?
Yeah, I go. Blah, 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 blah. I hate. I yeah. No.
this is what this car does with the front windows down. You put one down, it's like, but it's funny. It's like on 495 yesterday, I put the windows down, doing 70-ish.
What, you were speeding?
A little bit. I don't do a lot of things wrong. I tend to drive a little fast. Yeah, I was moving with the flow of traffic, and I was doing 70-ish, and it wasn't bad. I got off because traffic was backing up, like from people going to the Cape, and I got off at Route 138. And 138 going by Raynham and all that way, by the old Raynham Dog Track. Taunton Dog Track? Raynham Dog Track. One of those.
Raynham. Taunton, I think it's Taunton Raynham.
Yeah, whatever. By the old dog, whatever the dog track is. That's the speed limit on that road's 50. For some reason on that road, at 50, it was, and it was like, sheesh. And when I was coming home from Maine, now the Maine Turnpikes or whatever it is up there is 70 miles an hour. At 70 miles an hour, 70, 75, 80, it was awful. And put the windows up, and it was quiet, smooth.
Again, aerodynamics.
Aerodynamics. But that, there has to be a way to, it's a hatchback. And the way the glass is designed in the back, if they made it so you put the windows down and the rear glass tilted open like 2 inches.
Maybe.
I think that would solve the whole problem.
Well, I mean, you get it in my car. Like, and it, yeah. It's the way yeah. the aerodynamics yeah. work in
but,
cars nowadays.
But like my car, for instance, if I put the driver's window down, my hair is blowing around. If I put the back window down
just
an
a little
inch,
bit, yeah,
it solves the whole problem.
Right, but even then, sometimes you still get the whoa, 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 yeah. whoa, whoa, whoa.
Yeah, this makes it uncomfortable. But if you're somebody who was just cruising out, and if you were doing a cross country tour or drive in this car with the windows up, be the most comfortable car in the world. So the buffeting's a little bit of an issue. The controls are pretty straightforward, not too aggravating. Shifter feels like a shifter. I think most everything brakes stop great. This looks like it's been out on a track a little bit. The tires look like someone's been pushing them pretty hard. But I think overall handling performance really good. It really a fun car to drive. Price wise. 45 to 55, I guess that's the range. The launch edition, which is kind of what this is, it's a special edition, so sort of the top of the line model, kind of in that $55,000-$56,000 range. But it's if you're looking for a car that gathers a little bit of attention, in fact, I may try to today find a cruise night or a car show or something. Kind of rinse some of the main bugs off of it, and bring it to a car show just to see what kind of attention it gets, because I think it's gonna get some.
It looks completely different from the front and the back, like completely yep. from the back. It yep. looks like it's one of those really angular, weird looking mm-hmm. cars, and then you see it from the front, and it looks like the BMW Z25 or whatever that
Z4
whatever. Yep. Yeah, yeah. I'm not a BMW person.
But it is it's a car that only one person said to me, most everybody else said to me, you got the new Supra? And I said, yeah, for the weekend. The person from Toyota wanted me to drive it for the weekend, and I said, okay, I will. So again, if you were looking at sort of a... If you remember the old Toyota Supra, which are selling for crazy money now because they're kind of collector items and people use them for drift cars, again, the Fast and Furious type, this is probably, size-wise, 8/10 of a Supra, 9/10 of a Supra. It's a little smaller than the old Supra was.
It's actually thinner, too.
It's a little bit, yeah, maybe a little bit. Stuff like storage and stuff. I have a bunch of stuff crammed in it right now. It's actually pretty roomy in the trunk. It's a weird hatchback. I have an amazing amount of stuff in there right now.
have to see.
Yeah. But it's but yeah, it's a pretty it's but if you're looking for a true sports car that you can drive every day, be comfortable in, doesn't beat you up ride-wise, has a sport mode which kind of tinkers with the ride and handling and all of that, it's I think it can make you happy. It will bring a smile to your face. So that's my thoughts. Why don't we take another break? When we come back, we'll talk about Elvis Presley's cars and what's going on with them. You can buy one. You can buy one of the Elvis Presley car. We'll be right back. She said, I don't want your Chevrolet. I don't want your Chevrolet. I don't want nothing in the world you got. No, you can't do nothing for me. You can't do nothing. Up with an Elvis song?
Again, I have no control over the songs anymore. I just press a button.
All right, coming up on August 31st, rare and personal cinematic starring motorcycles, vehicles, including Elvis's personal limo and Harley Davidson. And I don't know why anybody would want this. Elvis's own medical devices.
Because people be dumb. We've established this.
How about some stuff that Kurt Cobain owned?
As long as it isn't...
The shotgun?
Yes.
Steve McQueen's film-worn clothing.
I can see that.
Yeah. Marilyn Monroe's jewelry.
Sure.
Something that James Dean had. Johnny Cash and many others. But Cruise Auctions... They're going to have a Hollywood and music memorabilia auction going on Saturday, August 31st, rather. The Artifacts of Hollywood auction begin at 10 Pacific time. The event will be preceded by an exciting pop. Why does everybody do pop-ups? Public pop-up exhibit.
Because that's the rage right now.
I know it is. Of all the icons on the big screen, none are more electrifying than the Hollywood Rebel, a persona that... Bad Boys, blah, 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 blah. Highlights will include Elvis Presley's own vehicles, including his limo and his Harley, personal items from Kurt Cobain, Steve McQueen, Marilyn Monroe, Jerry Lee Lewis, Prince, and others. The motorcycle looks pretty interesting. And the limousine featured all the amenities of the era, including a TV, white-on-white model with a white exterior, interior, and roof. It's been on exhibit at the Elvis Presley Museum in Pigeon Forge, Tennessee. It's now available for the first time in auction. I wonder why they'd choose to auction it off when it's been on display for so long.
Money.
Money.
Okay. They need money.
Photos including included show Elvis, who was deputized by local law enforcement. And apparently that happened after he was driving the car and he was stopped in Memphis. And they made him an honorary sheriff or something. another offering, they will auction off his last motorcycle. It was purchased in 1976. Elvis flew back to his honeymoon house in Palm Springs, California, and while on the West Coast, bought a 1976 Harley Davidson FLH 1200 electric glide. On the 11th of the month, the custom painted Harley Davidson has low original mileage on the speedometer and has been on display at the Pioneer Auto Museum in South Dakota since the late 1980s. This rare one-of-a-kind motorcycle was owned by Presley and comes with all the papers, historical documentation, including title, registration, with Elvis's name on it. Interestingly, it was the only vehicle in the museum the public could not touch. It was ensconced behind a glass case. So I guess if you want something like that. The other weird stuff are some of his medical devices, which included a something, ophthalmoscope, a blood pressure cuff, a thermometer, a medical light, a stethoscope. Weird. A TCB necklace. You know what TCB is? What Sully just said, taking care of business. Limited edition diamond version. There's also, I don't know, something, 1956 press release about his debut album. And a third vehicle, his Circle G Ranch GMC pickup truck, one of three he bought for his new property in 1967. So a lot of weird stuff, and pretty good-looking pickup truck, too. And for the definition of cool, Steve McQueen still, according to this, still holds the title. I don't disagree with that. But there's going to be some of his stuff, some of James Dean's stuff. Pretty interesting auction, but you can check it out. It's GWS Auctions, Cruise GWS Auctions, and the website, if you want to check it all out, is gwsauctions.com. You can bid online if you want, so you can spend all your money on stuff you haven't seen, but you can end up with it. Let's talk to Tom. Tom, good morning.
Hey, good morning, John. Quiet morning out there, huh?
So you're gonna bid on Elvis Presley's limo?
No, I'm beyond that. To be honest with you, my goal is just keep staying alive. That's about it.
Well, you could buy his motorcycle.
Yeah, you're right. I do ride a motorcycle. I just have my one. I love it, and that's it. Enough for me. But you were talking like trivial things, how you said what they're telling the young people today what to do. Don't forget all this crazy stuff. Drink water. And one of them was, roll your windows down in your car. when you get it. It's kind of crazy, with things they're doing. And I was watching them on Carson Beach. They had all the kids down there. And it was incredible how much they kind of nursemaid them. They're running around giving them bottles of water. Mm-hmm. And I'm looking at it and saying, what a waste of money, bottles of water. Because the kid's going to take a few drinks, put it down. Then the water's going to be about 150 degrees when he comes back, right? And it's going to be useless. Instead of having some kind of a bubble there with cups. I mean, just everything is a waste today. Go on about this. Yeah. And then the other one you mentioned was opening your windows. I'm the same. I love opening my windows, and I'm a watcher of people, and I watch everybody sealed up in their car. And then all winter, all they do is complain about it's so cold. And then as soon as it warms up, they're in a nice box car.
Yeah. I was listening to another radio station this morning, and they're out interviewing somebody, or a whole bunch of people, and they were saying it's hot, it's too hot, and then they're like, well, how is it at work? It's too cold.
Right.
And this one woman said, I haven't been able to wear any of my fancy sundresses because it's too cold in the office and it's too hot at work. And she's like, I have to bring a hooded sweater to work because it's too cold in the office.
Right. And, I just don't remember people complaining as much years ago. We just brainwashed. The media goes overboard to reinforce people. Oh, it's hot, it's going to be, instead of just accepting it or whatever.
Well,
you got to
try to make something out of nothing sometimes when it's, I don't want to say there's nothing going on in the world, but because there's a bunch of stuff going on in the world.
Sure.
But on the other hand, you have to be able to say things like, well, it's going to be hot, and make a whole story out of hot. And the last time it was this hot, the last time the record for a hot day was something like 25 years ago. So it's not it's not like it hasn't been hot before. It's been hot.
Yeah, what it was is, exactly. And like on the window thing, I just took a ride out on the Mass Pikes. I never go anywhere too much anymore. I don't really have to. And it was like a 50-mile ride, and it was gorgeous out. And I drove the whole way with the windows down.
Yep.
It was so pleasurable, And I'm watching every car sealed up. I do understand if you have somebody in and you want to talk, mm-hmm. that creates a buzz by myself, you know?
Yep.
And just one more only because it's a quiet morning out there, you know? And you were mentioning about, you know, when we were kids, you're right. I don't remember ever being hot. I just remember playing. Your mother wouldn't even know you were gone for the day, and you'd survive. You'd be up at a ballpark playing a ball game.
Yep.
There'd be a bubble. You'd drink some water or something.
Yep.
You know, and then, you know, if you were fortunate to be one of the kids that your mother was able to give you a dime, you know, you'd stop in a little corner. I grew up in the city, Boston, and you'd run in and you'd get a Coke, a bag of chips or something like that. And if you were one of the unfortunate that didn't, they would try to steal it. You know?
I remember that. But, no, it's funny. It's funny. I at work now, we have, I don't know, four buildings on the same street. So every once in a while, there's a meeting at one of the buildings down the street. And I was going down to do something. And this was 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago, I guess. And it was a hot day. It was 85 degrees or so. Mm-hmm. And one of the younger people I work with said, make sure you bring a bottle of water with you. And I'm like, I'm walking 100 yards. You know, it's like, well, they're like, you know, it's hot outside. Make sure you stay. I'm like, I'm walking 100 yards. It's not any further than that. I'm sure I'll be okay. And maybe it was 200 yards. But, you know, it wasn't like I was walking to Michigan. You know, I was walking down the street. I'm pretty sure I survived the entire way.
Yeah, no. It's all out of hand.
Yeah.
Another one, I go up to Four River Bridge a lot. And so sometimes you get stuck on it. And again, a beautiful day, 75 degrees. Yep. And I'm stuck up on the bridge, and I'm one of the first cars.
Mm-hmm.
And as I watch all the cars, I actually got out and walked over to the side. Hey, look at some sun on me. And everybody just staying in their car, windows all rolled up, wasting gas for 20 damn minutes.
Yeah, no, and you're right.
What's that society coming to?
I know.
And let me just say this. If you were ever on that bridge, it's surrounded by water. It's 10 degrees cooler up there.
Yeah, you're right. And you know, kind of enjoy it. Hey, we got to take another break.
Yeah.
All right.
Good take care, Tom. Take care. Bye-bye.
Let's take that last break in the morning. My name's John Paul. This is a Car Doctor program. No trivia today, but I have a trivia question all lined up for next week because Dennis would kill me if I tried to do it.
Absolutely. Yeah.
But we'll have one for next week. We'll be right back.
There's only one car that I need. It's been in the comfort and been in the American classic.
And welcome back to the Car Doctor program. Hey, I want to thank the folks at the Retired Men's Club of Arlington for having me out a couple weeks ago. And they actually put something in the Arlington Advocate with a little picture of me. So thanks to them. So we were talking about electric cars earlier. Dodge sees electric future for its performance cars. Dodge has built its brand around being unabashed purveyor of American muscle. But they also said they might be building some electric cars. So we'll have to wait and see. And I guess I can't go without mentioning the new Corvette.
No.
The new Corvette.
You've been talking about this thing for years.
I know. Well, I remember talking with the designer of the Corvette when the new C7 came out. And I said, and I started my conversation with, there's going to be a four-cylinder turbocharged mid-engine car. And he kind of didn't know what to say. And I said, I'm only kidding. I know it's going to be a front-engine, rear-wheel drive, big V8. And he said, yeah, that's what the Corvette's always going to be. Well, they've always talked about doing a mid-engine car. They've talked about doing a mid-engine Corvette for 30 years. And they finally have come out with it. And all of the spy photos of it looked like, I hate to say it, it looked like a typical mid-engine car. It's, you know, if you didn't know better from a distance, you go, is it a Ferrari? Is it a Lamborghini? Is it a McLaren? Is it a whatever? It has its own unique style, certainly. It's a V8. I think they're saying 500 horsepower or so in its entry-level phase. The most remarkable thing about the car is the price. They're saying it's going to be $60,000. Everybody was saying the new Corvette was going to be in the $90,000 to $100,000 range, like the top-of-the-line Corvette now, which is in the $90,000 range. If this thing is actually for sale at $60,000, they're not going to be able to build them fast enough. There will be people buying them everywhere because, and I can't imagine they're going to go anywhere near close to building very many of them, but it's going to be some big, big numbers are going to be on this particular car, and it's going to be amazing when it happens. If you wanted the last old Corvette, the last front-engine Corvette sold at a charity auction at Barrett Jackson for $2.7 million. So, Chevrolet finally introduced its 8th generation Corvette, the first production version, but it says the last C7, a Z06 with the 650 horsepower LT4 engine, 7-speed manual transmission, it sold on June 28th to an anonymous phone bidder, Jay Leno, maybe, I don't know, for $2.7 million. Proceeds went to a New York charity. $2.7 million for a $100,000 Corvette. That's a lot of money. That's a lot of money. Hey, I think we need to go.
It's getting close.
Isn't it time? Isn't it time?
Where are you going?
I don't know. There's Sully over there.
Hey.
Hey.
What up?
Haven't seen you in a while.
I know.
Yeah.
How do I look?
You look fantastic.
Thank you.
Tan.
I do.
Yeah. Muscular. Yeah.
Not so much. No.
Rested.
Have a deep red shirt on.
Rested.
Rested. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Got your Red Sox hat on.
I'm conflicted here because I got my curly W for the Washington Nationals on the shirt. And, that's for Zach. He's Nats fan.
Would make sense.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
Yep.
So what's up today for the Irish Hit Parade?
Well, it is the 50th anniversary of the lunar landing, so I tried to look through all my moon songs, so I will play every moon Irish song that I can find.
Did they really land on the moon?
Yes.
Yes, they landed on the moon.
All right.
Just because for the Irish tie-in, the astronaut that was orbiting didn't go down, didn't put his footsteps. His name was Michael Collins. Just like the great Irish patriot, Michael Collins.
Is it because, was there a sign that said no Irish need apply or something? Or?
You're getting into tricky ground
here.
Yeah, I know. You better say goodbye, bye-bye,
or
whatever.
That's what my grandmother told me.
What? You know? Well, yeah. I mean, talk about people who were oppressed, right?
Yeah.
You want to go back in history?
Yeah.
Why don't you start the campaign for reparations?
I'm all done.
Go ahead. Go for it.
I'm all done. It's time for me to go.
All right. Bye-bye.
Time for me to go. Very best in Irish music heard here every weekend on AM 950 WROL, starting with the Irish Hit Parade right now. Until next week, make sure you wear your seatbelt, drive safely, and be good to your car. Talk to you all next week. Bye-bye.
Trying to get you in the mood to sing this song with us. And there's a grand chorus in this. It's a song called The Liar. And listen carefully to this because there'll be questions before you.